My name is Sanne Stienstra. I'm with the Washington County Solid Waste and Recycling Program, just across the street. And usually we come out and talk about garbage and recycling, but today we're going to talk about what you can do before something becomes garbage or recycling in the first place. We're going to talk about one of my favorite things, which is food. So how many people like food? Okay, good. So I'll keep going. So as you all probably know, it takes a lot of resources to get food onto our tables. Valuable things like water, energy, land, labor, time, you know, just to kind of name some big overarching categories. And all these resources translate into money one way or another, right? So today, we're talking about food waste at the household level, so I just want to highlight a little bit about how much families spend on food. So middle-income families can spend about 13% of their household budgets on food, and low-income families, that's about 36%. So long story short, food is expensive. But we spend a lot of money on it because we need it to live and grow and be healthy. It also connects us to our communities, our cultures. It's a livelihood for some people. We have some holidays coming up that revolve around food, like what?
Thanksgiving.
I did this presentation for some kids the other day, but so they said Halloween, but so we spend a lot of money on food because we need it and maybe we even enjoy it. But what if you had to pay for the same food twice? So when I was a kid, my mom packed my lunch for me for school every day. And if I didn't eat something, she made me pay her back for it. So 50 cents for a banana that got smushed in the bottom of my bag, or a quarter for yogurt that maybe didn't make it to the end of the day if it was a hot day. And so that really bothered me at the time, but it taught me a really valuable lesson that, you know, it's not a good thing to waste food, and you know, it has impacts when you don't eat that food that was prepared for us to eat. So my point is that when we waste food, we pay for it over and over again in different ways. So some of those different ways are economic, like my mom sort of highlighted to me in a very serious way. We also have social impacts. So as many of you probably are aware, you know, we have some issues with food insecurity and hunger in this country. So when we're wasting food and at the same time other people don't have enough food to eat, that's kind of an opportunity to connect the dots a little better. And then there are the environmental impacts. So we'll go over some of those more specifically, but those valuable resources I was talking about earlier, when we use them to make food that we don't eat, that's a waste of resources. So, I gave it away. Hopefully you didn't see it. If you had to guess, if you didn't see the slide, how much food we waste in the US, what would you say? Or did everybody see it?
A lot of pounds.
A lot of pounds, yeah. What about a percentage? 40, yeah. So, man, that's the first time I've done that. yes, we waste about 40% of all the food that we grow for humans to eat. So how about I'll have you guess this one, since I don't have it on a slide and I can't ruin the surprise. How much do you think we waste in our homes, like food that our families buy at the grocery store? How much do we waste?
20, 30.
25, yeah, exactly. So that's like going to the grocery store, you leave with four big bags full of food, you drop one in the parking lot, and you just drive away. And I sort of set up that scenario because it's crazy and you would never actually do that, but that is in essence what we do. And for perspective on how this is a problem for us today, we're wasting about 50% more today than we did in the 1970s. So it's a problem that has gotten worse over time. So to look at those impacts a little more in depth, we have the economic ones, which I highlighted. So the annual value of food waste across the US is $165 billion a year, which is an amount I can't even fathom. And then at the household level, again, because that's where we're focusing today, the average family of four wastes about $1,600 a year on food they bought and never ate. So $1,600 a year is not an insignificant amount of money, and especially for some families over others, but I like to fantasize about what I would do with that extra $1,600 a year, and I have to say that the thing that I would buy first, at least, would be a really fancy Vitamix blender. Does anyone else, did anything pop in your head when I said, like, extra $1,600 a year, what would you do with that money?
Hawaii.
Travel. Yeah, good ones. I was at PCC talking to some college students, and somebody said, I would pay for this class. So there's a lot you can do with $1,600, clearly. So back to those social impacts, in the US, about 1 in 6 people isn't sure where their next meal is coming from, which is called food insecurity. And right here in Washington County, that's about 69,000 residents, or 13% of our population, isn't sure where their next meal is coming from. So again, I highlight these social impacts just sort of when you're reflecting on food waste, thinking about, again, kind of connecting those dots, these two things happening at the same time. And then the environmental impacts. So just for one example, about a quarter of all our freshwater supplies go to grow food that never gets eaten. And for me, that's particularly affecting because a lot of our food comes from California, which is in a really big drought. So you know, that percentage could be even higher in times of drought, I think. So that's something to think about too. And then finally, I just want to highlight when food waste rots in landfills, it creates methane, which is a greenhouse gas about 25 times more harmful than carbon dioxide. And so even if you're composting your food waste at home, which is a really good thing to do, if you're using food that you could have eaten, you're making some really expensive compost. So we love composting, but you know, for your food scraps is really the best way to create compost. So. We've looked at these impacts and we've talked about how much we waste in the US, but let's talk about how we waste. So even knowing all this, I know sometimes I waste food, even though it's literally my job not to. So who else has ever wasted food? Okay, thank you for your honesty. So is anybody willing to share a story, a specific time they can think of, or maybe something that happens regularly at home where you bought something and for whatever reason you didn't get to eat it? Yes, Tom.
I bought cabbage like last week for a certain recipe and I only used like a quarter of it, and then it sat in the bottom of my drawer and I didn't know what to do with it until I finally thought maybe I could do something with that cabbage and it was all brown.
Yeah, so buying something for a specific recipe and then you kind of don't know what to do with the rest of it. Yeah, anybody else? Yes.
My old refrigerator, and so I have it in on the porch, mm-hmm. from my refrigerator in the kitchen, and I forget what's in there.
Yes.
Because, of course, I don't open it every day.
Right. So kind of losing track of what's in your fridge, that's a really common one. Yes, right here.
I decided at the beginning of the week that I'm going to make like salads for lunch all week. Mm-hmm. And I buy all of the salad stuff, and then one thing happens, another, and I don't end up making salads, and then...
Yeah. Yeah, so you have a dynamic lifestyle, so you plan and things change. Yes, here.
I try to shop only like once a week,
mm-hmm.
and when I buy a lot of the produce, by the time I use it, like 2 or 3 days into the week, it's especially like lettuce and spinach and things like that, it's all gunky
yeah.
on the inside.
Yeah, so there's too much that you can't get through in time. And how about last one in the very back?
That was my same.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So thanks for sharing all those. Those are all really common ways that we waste food at home. And as you can maybe pick up, all these come from pretty good intentions. We all have good intentions when we buy this food and we plan our salads for the week and plan our veggies to eat, but we don't get to it. So these pictures represent some of those different things. I also, there are, you know, some amount of food waste happens from accidents like spills or burns. Also, some of you may be familiar with that face over there. So we have some picky eaters at home maybe. And then here's our, you know, less than ideal fridge scenario where you kind of can't keep track of what's in there because it's too full and there's definitely stuff in the back there that's rotting, just waiting to surprise you when you finally get back there. So thanks for all those good stories. So now I want to go into talking about what we can do about food waste. And again, like I said, we're talking about food waste at home. So Washington County Solid Waste and Recycling Program, we have the Eat Smart, Waste Less Challenge, which I'm going to tell you all about today. And it was designed to help you just make really small, simple kind of tweaks to your regular routine to prevent this food waste. So I'm going to go through a few different tools. And the first thing we're going to talk about is storing your fruits and vegetables in the right place. And this may seem really basic, but I found that we can fill in sort of gaps of knowledge in different places for a lot of different people. So this is kind of, we think this is the easiest tool and gets the best results, so that's why we're starting here. So I'm actually going to get your help today with some storage. So I have, pretend like this is our kitchen, and you all probably can't see the signs, but this is inside the fridge, and on the counter or table, and then in a cool, dark place, like a cupboard or pantry. So where do you think we should store this? It's a zucchini, so it stays fresh for the longest. Yeah, so I heard a few different things, but we would recommend inside the fridge in your crisper drawer. How many people use their crisper drawers? And how many of you know how it works? That's the response I get every single time. So usually your fridge probably has two drawers, and the idea is that you use one for low humidity and one for high humidity, and so you can, ideally, not all fridges, but most fridges have a setting. So you can do one high humidity, one to low, and you can move them. And in your high humidity drawer, you want to have things that wilt. They're sensitive to moisture loss. So in the high humidity drawer, it keeps more of the moisture in. And then in the low humidity drawer, you want things that are more sensitive to rotting, not wilting. And so that lets more of the moisture out. So you think low rot, high wilt. So that's how you can hopefully try to remember some of those things. And something like a zucchini is more prone to rotting, so you would put it in your low humidity drawer.
Does that mean the crisper drawer?
Yeah. Okay. So you probably have two crisper drawers. So if one's high, one's low, there's ideal places for your vegetables and fruit in those two different ones. Okay, so how about this winter squash? Counter or cupboard, I heard a few different things. So either one is probably fine. As long as your kitchen's not really hot, out on the counter is okay. If you want to do longer term storage, then a cupboard would be better.
If that's in the fridge, does it just go bad faster? Why wouldn't you put it in the fridge?
I don't know if it would actually harm it to put it in the fridge, but I think that a lot of people don't have enough space, but also I think it gets sweeter if you keep it in the dark. That's what I've read.
I put it directly in the compost.
The whole thing? Oh, man. Talk to Leah, she'll eat it. All right, how about this avocado?
It depends on what state it's in.
Exactly. So tell me the different states.
So my husband loves avocado. So if it's not ripe yet, I leave it on the counter. If it's getting to ripe or almost due ripe, I put it in the fridge.
Yeah, that's exactly right. So if it gets to that point where it's ripe and ready to eat, but maybe you can't eat it that second, you can put it in the fridge and save it for a few more days. And avocados are pretty sensitive, so you kind of have to be on top of that. But even if it is brown, you can like squeeze some citrus on it, and that'll help it prevent browning. Or if you cut it open, leave the pit inside, and it'll help keep that second half or quarter that you have left a little bit longer. So I'll put it in the fridge because let's assume that it's ripe. So how about this onion? Cool, dark place. Yeah, I would say cool, dark place. And what else goes in a cool, dark place?
Potatoes.
Does anybody know anything about storing potatoes and onions together? You shouldn't do it because onions make potatoes sprout. So yes. So keep them separate from each other. I mean, you want them in a cool, both in a cool, dark place, but away from each other. You can also, if you're trying to grow potatoes, put them with an onion, and then you'll get some sprouted potatoes. Yes.
Well, I've heard that you put an onion in the fridge if you don't want it, the whole tearing effect when you cut it, though, that it prevents that.
Oh, I've never heard that before, but that's an interesting one. So she said you put an onion in the fridge to prevent crying when you cut open an onion. So I've not heard that, but something to try.
Why do they put onions in the cupboard? Because I always keep mine in the fridge because I get a bigger bag, and then I'm able to keep it there for a lot longer.
If you have a big bag of onions, then yeah, I think the best place would be a basement. I mean, onions and potatoes are grown in the ground. They just like it cooler and darker, and I think a fridge will make onions kind of wrinkle. I don't know if your onions start to do that. And again, so actually what I should have said in the beginning was, if you're doing something different than this, don't change what you're doing just because I said so, if you're not having waste. So if you find some things are going bad, then maybe try this new strategy. But Leah, if you have your onions in the fridge and that works for you, keep doing it. So these are just kind of, like I said, fill in the knowledge gaps where they might be.
A dumb question, but like, how far away did onions have to be from the potatoes? like touching, or?
I would just say like not in the same container. Yeah. Ideally in a more open space. So, but if you have them in a cupboard, like with a closed door, then definitely like different shelves or something like that. Yeah. All right, last one. How about this apple?
Fridge.
Fridge, yes. I would say fridge as well. You keep it in your crisper drawer for a month or more. If you have like a lot of apples, you can do long-term storage in your basement. But some people don't like cold apples, so I would say just pull out a few from the fridge, put them on the counter, whatever you're gonna eat in the next day or two, and just kind of cycle through them that way. I had a family come up to me at the farmer's market. They said they always buy really big bags of apples. They put half right into the fridge, half out on the counter, and then they're not, nothing is, you know, has a chance to kind of go bad. For apples, I would say low. Because they're more, I would say apples are more sensitive to rot than wilt. Okay. Yeah. Okay, great. Well, thanks everyone. That was fun. Is there any others you want to throw out? Yes.
You said the avocado, when I'm storing that, take the seed out when I'm storing it?
No, so if you've cut into it, like say you ate half of it, yeah, and you want to save half, keep the pit in that half. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Or even like when you make guacamole and take it to a party or something, leave the pit in and it doesn't brown as quickly.
Okay, good to know.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, Peter.
So I don't remember where I heard it, but it seems to help for some vegetables. I actually now cut the ends off and then stand them in water.
Mm-hmm.
Things like leafy greens, celery, asparagus, they last forever. Whereas normally they would not last long at all.
Yeah.
It's kind of hard to do in the fridge because you have to have some vertical.
Some room, yeah.
Really important.
Yeah, I've heard that too. That's a good one. And also with your leafy greens, if you put them like in a storage container in layers with like towels in between, that kind of has a similar, like moist towels in between, similar effect. Yeah. Yes?
You can use the standing in water thing with fresh herbs also.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Fresh herbs. Definitely. Cool. Thanks, everyone. So before we go on to our next strategy, the strategy, our tool, we have this fruit and vegetable guide storage magnet. So all these tools I'm going to talk about are going to be available to you to take home if you're interested today. So that's the tool here. And that's our website, eatsmartwasteless.com. And so we have an A to Z storage guide there. So if you think of any others that you want to look up, you can reference our website there and look it up in the guide. And then we also have a lot of freezing tips. So to prevent food waste at home and, you know, using storage as a tool, I think your freezer is a great, great tool. You can freeze almost anything, especially if it's just for a couple days until you get to it. So there's some really good freezing tips on the website too. So moving on to more things you can do, we encourage people to measure their food waste at home if you would like to see where your opportunity is to prevent waste, and then also as you implement these tools, see how they're working for you. So we have those 4-quart buckets there, so you can measure your waste, and you would just want to measure the food you could have eaten, so not your scraps and peels that you wouldn't have normally eaten. And then we have this food waste diary, so you can kind of keep track by day or by week of what you're wasting, and then you can see, you know, at the end of a week or a month, say you've always got a lot of tomatoes you're tossing out, you can kind of adjust and buy fewer tomatoes. I did this myself and it's really, really interesting. It's also a fun thing to do with your family, like if you have kids in the house, they can help you measure and keep track, and it's a good way to get engaged. And then we also have this decal. It says, eat this first. So you put it on a clear bin or other container like that in the fridge, and you can put your leftovers and your fruits and veggies that need to be eaten soon in there. So anyone who opens the fridge, they know to check this place first for a snack or if they're gonna cook something. And I like this too because you're kind of constantly doing an inventory. At least I am. Every time I open my fridge, I'm thinking about what needs to move there too. So that kind of helps in a really simple way cut back on losing track of what's in the fridge.
I suppose you could do that in the freezer too, right?
Yeah, yeah. Definitely. And then buy what you need. So we talked about going to the grocery store only once a week. We do encourage, well, usually shopping more often helps reduce food waste because you're buying smaller amounts more often. So if you have the time, that can help. We also have meal planning and grocery list shopping pad here. So who shops with a grocery list already? Cool. And who does anybody do meal planning? A little bit, yeah. Yeah, so I like this pad because you can kind of do loose meal planning, fill it in on the day of the week. You don't have to stick to that item that day, but it just kind of helps you plan how much food you need for a week. And then you can always leave a day blank if you want to eat leftovers or have room to go out, and then you can kind of switch your days around depending on, you know, what your schedule ends up looking like. And then finally, our last tool is called Smart Prep. So this is something that takes a little more work up front, but saves time later. So if you come home from the store, you have a little time, you can chop some potatoes that you're going to use for a soup later in the week. And then when Wednesday comes around and you're tired and you were supposed to make that soup, but your potatoes are already chopped up, that makes it a lot easier. So we have these labels that kind of help you track that stuff that you prepare in advance, just the item when you prepped it, and whatever is useful for you to track it. So so those are all our strategies. And so now I would like to invite you all, if you are interested, to take our pledge to prevent food waste at home. So you all came today, I assume you're interested in this. So our campaign, well, it's our challenge, so we call it a challenge, and you just take a little pledge that says, I'm gonna try to prevent food waste at home, and you can take home any of these tools that you want to help you in that effort. And so I'm gonna start passing around these clipboards, and if you want to just put your name and your email address. I'll just follow up one email a week for 4 weeks. You'll have opportunities to win some prizes as well if you fill out a survey when we send it to you. And today, I will also give away some of these prizes that we have to those of you who sign up today. So some of our prizes are these nice reusable produce bags and these reusable snack pouches. So I'll give away these three. I'll pick some random winners from the list when you sign up. And so just check the boxes for the strategies you want to try. And then what I'll also do is I'll start sending around piles of the tools. So if you want one, just take it and then pass on the pile. If you don't want one, just pass on the pile. So there's a lot of you and a few different things. So we'll just start kind of like circulating, and then we can come back to questions. So I'll just start these real quick and then come back to questions here. So if you like one, you can take it and pass it on. Start back here. We can start here. So if you like one, you can take it and then pass it on. Like one, you can take it, and then if you could pass it down, that would be great. Okay, so lastly, I just wanted to recap some of the benefits of preventing food waste at home. So we kind of talked about a lot of these indirectly, but I just like to highlight them, how it can help you at home. So, you know, we talked about saving money, up to $1,600 a year for a family of four. We can protect the environment by not using more resources than what we need. We can develop healthier eating habits. So we talked, actually in a couple different places, we talked about buying more fruits and vegetables and then wasting some of them. So we waste about a quarter of all the fresh produce that we buy, but most people don't actually get enough fresh produce. So if we just eat more of what we're already buying, then you have an opportunity to eat healthier. And you can teach your kids good food habits, like we kind of talked about with the measurement, get them involved with their food and their meals, and then feel good wasting less. So I know I do. I just kind of discovered my new favorite salad the other day that I made out of just really random stuff that was in my fridge, but now I'm gonna make it again and go out and buy those specific things because it was so good and it was a nice surprise. So the stuff is passing around. I'll also pass these out at the end, but now if you have any questions, I'm happy to take them. So thank you.